All right, welcome everybody to the second session of Reggae University. Today we will talk about the dance aspect of dancehall. The title is Girl or Bubble, Female Empowerment or Objectification in Dancehall. Hosted by David Katz on the far right, next to him is Pierre Tosi from Italy, and next to me is Ellen Köhlings, and I'm Pete Lilly, both from Germany. Let me start to introduce our special guests. Next to Ellen is Maggie Burning, better known as Swaggy Maggie, who was the official German dancehall queen in 2010. Maggie studied at Edna Manley College and the University of the West Indies in Kingston, where she extended her education in Caribbean dance and culture. And she organizes various dancehall events, classes and workshops, as well as the annual top-up Jamaica trip, where she brings students and dancers from Europe to Jamaica for them to get to know dancehall straight from the source. Next to Maggie is Ale Vanille, who was born and raised in Rome, Italy, where she was also crowned dancehall queen in 2007. In 2014, as we could see in the documentary that was just screened, she represented Italy at the International Dancer Queen Contest in Montego Bay and won the third place. She also organizes and hosts various competitions and workshops in Italy, and has been in music videos of artists like iOctane, Tifa, War 21 and the Italian band Sud South System. Next to Ale Vanille is Carolyn Cooper, a dancer. Oh. Anyway, not really next to Ale Vanille, but the next person is Carolyn Cooper, who is a dancer queen in her own right. The professor of literature has written several books and essays about the significance of dancehall. She is the author of Noises in the Blood, Orality, Gender, and the Vulgar Body of Jamaican Popular Culture, as well as Sound Clash, Jamaican Dancehall Culture at Large. And she has been in the jury of the International Dancehall Queen Contest in Montego Bay. And next to Carolyn is the filmmaker Corey McKenna. Who is an editor for the Last Week Tonight show at the US TV station HBO. And she directed the documentary that we just saw, Brockout, that was just screened. Corey, I would like to put the first question to you. What aroused your interest to do a documentary like Brockout?
Is everybody okay hearing me? Okay. I think when I first saw Dancehall Queens as an outsider to the culture, they were just objects to me, just like I thought they would be to everybody else, to men. And I was wondering why they were doing what they were doing, and I wanted to know why. So I wanted to meet them as people and not just as objects, and to have them explain themselves, because you see a lot in the media, you see women dancing, but you don't hear them talking about their own lives.
I thought it's especially, you know, at the beginning of the film, I really liked the scene of the little girl dancing, because I remember when I came to Jamaica the first time, you know, as Europeans, we are normally not so used to this expressiveness of the body. And when I went to Jamaica for the first time, it was really like a three-year-old girl making all the moves which were in the dance hall. And then I really had to think, oh wow, it's something different. It's not like the view as a European you can put on it, which might look like, whoa, this is a sexist thing, or what are the women doing? And I thought it was a nice point to start off the film. And maybe you can tell us a bit about, you know, how you went about the film, because it was very intense, and I thought it's an awesome documentary what you did, you know, with all the different angles you took.
Thank you. Yeah. So you want to know more about the opening?
Yeah.
Yeah. The opening of the film was a little bit controversial, because maybe American, especially white American males, they see that scene, and they think, oh, this is wrong. I don't want to look at this little girl dancing. And I think it, as you learn more about the culture in the film, you understand that that's not the case. And I think it's provocative enough to bring people in from outside and still explain, you know, from the inside, the way that they want to tell their story as well.
I just wanted to say that, to be honest, I felt some discomfort with the opening. I felt that the little girl was being exposed in a problematic way. So maybe I am one of the dissenting voices. I don't think it's just white males from outside Jamaica who might be uncomfortable with that representation, because there is a sense of innocent, childish play that we see, you know, children just sort of rolling around and having fun. But I felt right at the very beginning, and especially with the focus on her little panties, and I felt uncomfortable. Perhaps afterwards I could rationalize it, but in the moment of viewing, I had a problem with the way the little girl was being represented.
Yeah, I had a question for you, Corey. I just one of the things I appreciated about the film was the way that you brought the human aspect to life so well. And you, like you were saying before, your intention was really to have your subjects tell their own stories, which I thought they all came across very well. So I just wondered, how easy was it for you to actually get to know your subjects and have them open up to you? And how long did it take you to make this film as well?
It took about 2.5 years total. Getting to know Ali Vanille, Alessandra, was very difficult because she's obviously a very difficult person. I'm just kidding. She's lovely. Obviously, all the dancehall queens, they opened up in a different timeline. But they're all very expressive people by nature, and I feel like they wanted to tell their story, so it wasn't very difficult, except for the Jamaicans I found to be quite difficult because I'm an outsider. And so getting them to trust me that I would not, you know, exploit them, I felt like that was the hardest part. And so hopefully, you know, they can see this and tell me how they feel. But yeah, all the dancehall queens are very open with me, yeah.
And Corey, were you in love with the music before and the culture, or what drew you in to do it?
Yeah, no, I was really interested in the music and the culture, and but I wanted to know from the women especially, because that was the thing that drew me in. And I felt like, also, you say it in the end of the film, you can do anything you want because you're free. That's the core of what I was feeling. Like, I saw them and I felt what you said, and I wanted to know about that.
I want to put a question to the two dancers. What made you turn to Jamaican dancehall dancing as Europeans? What got your interest? It's more than an interest, it's a passion, I guess. And, you know, what rose that passion?
All right. I just fell in love with the music going to dancehall parties in my hometown in Germany. So I just felt the energy and the vibe of the music, and I started to move to it. Even I didn't know how the special or specific moves were executed, but then I got to know little by little and learning, yeah, little by little, what was behind the dance. So it was really the music grabbed me, and then I didn't understand the lyrics, so I searched for them on YouTube. And I found out it was about dancing, so that kept my interest. And then I went to research, which was hard because I couldn't travel to Jamaica at that time. But some sources, some DVDs, some YouTube videos, some people who've been to Jamaica before. So yeah.
Yeah, before to dancehall, I used to dance different kind of dance, like ballet, modern jazz, everything. And I only knew the music, but nothing about the dance. Then my friend showed me a DVD about Dancehall Queen, so only Dancehall Queen at the beginning. And I felt in love at really the first moment. So I tried by myself to dance, because at that time, 2006, nobody was in Rome, like dancing dancehall. And I went to Jamaica after my first competition. And there, everything changed for me, because I could see all the rest. So not all the female part, but the dancing tune and how they share the dance in the party. It was magic. I never find something like that, never. And when I started to use this dance for me, I really felt free. Because I could express every emotion. So not only the girly moment or, you know, the sensuality, but I can play around with the dancing tune and do funny things, or I can be aggressive with the bad tunes. So I really find myself in this music and dance at the fullest. And I left all the other kind of work I did. I used to dance in television, theater, everything in my country. And I left everything because I felt I need to go deep. And then I start to go to Jamaica many, many, many times every year since now. So,
yeah. I have a question for the dancers too, and it's about the acceptation and the appreciation in Jamaica for foreign dancers. I mean, it's not so unusual to have foreign dancers now in Jamaica and in recent years, in the last 8 years, because some pioneers, as for example the famous Japanese dancer Junko, came before you. But the question is, the very first acceptation and appreciation by the Jamaicans, and if it was different for men and women, I mean Jamaican men and Jamaican women.
All right, I went to Jamaica. Thank you. For the first time in 2011, that was after Alemanil, my experience was that, first of all, most of the dancers in Jamaica, they are men. What we just saw is a part of the dancehall dancing culture, which is dancehall queen style, but it's just a part of the dancing. And if you go to a dancehall party in Jamaica, me mainly in Kingston, it's 90% males dancing. And the male dancing part makes out the biggest part of the dancing. Like right now, the girl time is just a small time. So most of the male and most of the dancers are males, male Jamaicans. And me, as a white European, they first saw me as visa money, get out. Yeah, as an object. Yes. So I noticed that I got respect from those male dancers in the moment when they realized I'm not there to have sex, but I'm there for dancing, and I'm a dancer, and I'm there to dance, and I can prove that I can do that. Yeah. Especially that I can do also the male dances, not only the dancehall queen side, which I was not even doing by that time, but the male dances. So that's when I got respect from them, yes.
Yeah, and comparing with, for example, 2007 when I start, now the things are better, because they see that we are some Europeans really interested in them culture. So it's not going there for holidays. They can see we go deep, we learn, we respect and support the culture. Because we really support the culture, not only in Jamaica, but also when we are in Europe, bringing the Jamaican dancers or many, many things we can do. So now it's definitely better, I think.
I have a question for Carolyn. The subtitle for today's session is Female Empowerment or Objectification in Dancehall. Can you explain in how far sexually kind of explicit dancing can be female empowerment?
Well, first of all, I have to say that despite my reservations about the opening with that little girl, I thought the film was powerful, really a beautiful expression of female empowerment. And I think, the problematic issue is How do you see the body? Is the body in dance something that you're going to see as negative, and therefore you're going to say the woman is disempowered because she has become an object? You know, the thing that drew you in, here are these objects dancing. Where is a human dimension to them? And I think it's the sheer joy in the body that is emancipatory, that is a celebration of the woman and the celebration of her body. That is definitely positive. So, you know, you're going to get the fundamentalist Christians who are going to say that the body should be mortified, the flesh is sinful and so on, and you shouldn't be dancing like that. But I think if you engage in the dance yourself, you will feel that liberation and you will enjoy that sense of possession of your body and being able to express pleasure in the body. So I definitely see it as emancipatory, although I do understand that there are people who might see it negatively.
Yeah, I actually want to include the the dancers. Yeah, just go ahead.
I just want to add to that point that I think is important from where we look at dancer queens. If you look at them in Jamaica as Jamaicans, or if you look at them in all over the world, Europe, for example, from a European perspective, because dancing in Jamaica, and especially dancehall queen style, is very expressive, but it's a great way of entertainment. So the entertainment part is a big, big part as well in the daggering. And for people who do know this culture in Europe, it might not be entertaining. So the perspective is just a little different.
I myself often have heard comparisons between dancehall dancing and go-go club dancing. I'm sure you come across that as well. How do you respond to that?
They can dance. I mean, yeah, it's different how they show the body. I can give you an example. I'm not the type of dancehall queen so extreme. Maybe for the trick, I love the extreme trick, but not so extreme sexual. So this is me, this is just me. So I think it depends how you want to use your body. This is my body, so I use how I want. I decide how the people is gonna look at me, is gonna watch me. So this is me. When I approach to the slackness lyric, for me, I don't feel like scandal. I feel fun, like, sorry for my English, but it's, I don't know, I like having fun, make me smile how they approach the sexuality. It's not a taboo, they're really free. Also with the body or with talking, where they are talking about sex, they are free. So I like the way how they can free up the mind also in this part. But this is what I feel about it.
Yes, I know this comparison very well. And most of the times when I tell people what I do, and I do it for a living, I say dancehall dancing, they look at me, oh, okay, so you do dancehall dancing. So they immediately have this image of us is shaking and I don't know, in their minds, which is, as I said, a part. And that's the reason, because of this image dancehall has in Europe, because I'm from Europe. Because I never felt really comfortable with doing dancehall queen style. Even I won the dancehall queen contest in Germany, but it's because I didn't have more information about the male dancing style, which is what I mostly do now. So another reason, the second reason why I kind of stopped to do dancehall queen style dancing is because I want to show in Germany, first of all, then Europe, that dancehall is not just about dancehall queen style, and that dancehall can be done by male, and it doesn't have to be daggering, it doesn't have to be heads up, it doesn't have to be those things. It can be, and it can be classy, yes. but I want other dancers from other dancers to respect dancehall, because we have a big issue with that. Because most of dancers who do practice at the dancers, they do not respect us at dance hall dancers, because they only think of us as, you know, yeah.
Can I just add something? I think if we talk about the erotic versus the vulgar, we're sort of in the domain of go-go dancing versus dancehall dancing, but I think it's a continuum that go-go dancing is on the same plane as dancehall dancing, girls dancing, because dancehall is about the erotic, so is go-go dancing, but in a sense, if you can put the label of art on the form, as in dancehall, it becomes more acceptable than go-go dancing, which requires a lot of skill, but because it is presumed to be leading to commercial sex, then it gets a negative label, you know. But I think if we try to suspend some of the labels, we can see that there's a real continuum between go-go dancing and dancehall dancing.
And Maggie, I find it very interesting that you said you're dancing more like the male guys are dancing now, and I know you got a lot of Jamaican dancers to Europe. So how did they, you know, react as a woman that you take part now in this kind of male dancing? So what was it like, you know, when you said to yourself, okay, I want to, you know, not only do the dancehall queen style?
No, as I said before, that's what, that was the point when they started to really respect me. That is my, yeah, my impression. That's the word. That's my impression. So very friendly. They're inviting. Like when you go to Kingston, that's what we love so much about going to Kingston as a dancer, because they're so friendly. They're inviting you to share the dance with them, to dance with them. They show you their moves. They want you to do their moves. So, yeah, absolutely positive.
Can I ask, do you think that the male dancing is somehow more respectable for a woman than the dancehall queen dancing?
More respectable?
Yes.
In Jamaica or in
either space? In either Europe or Jamaica?
No, I wouldn't say. Okay. No, I can't generalize, because
yes.
I think
for
in
you,
Jamaica,
for you.
Yeah, I think in Jamaica both styles are very respected. And they respect dancer queens as much as they respect the male dancers. But yes, the people I know in Europe, mm-hmm. they more respect the male dancing style.
Right. Why? Yes. Because the female dancing is more provocative.
It's too sexual provocative, yes. for mm-hmm. them. Yes. And they don't see the entertainment part. Mm-hmm. They don't.
And, you know, you both also organize trips to Jamaica with European dancers. So what is it like? What expectations do the people have, the dancers, when they haven't been to Jamaica before? How is their reaction when they enter a Jamaican dancer? Which is so special. What we all love about it, the vibes, the energy is just... So maybe you can tell us a bit about this experience.
Yeah, I started 3 years ago, and before, at the beginning, just with Italian people. And this year, just 1 month ago, it was with also people from Europe. And I created this project with Latonia Style from DanceJA. Yeah, I was her first student, and for me, my first teacher. At that time, when I came to Jamaica, she, you know, has a school, so I just call learn from the party, and I used to call her to private class. So really, she helped me to understand a lot about Jamaican culture. And anytime I came back to Jamaica, I did like a program for myself, like, okay, this month I want to study traditional folk, old school, middle school, new school, and everything. And then I felt I want to share this with the people, and especially with my people, because in Italy there is not so culture, not so many culture knowledge about Jamaican culture. So I started to do it for my group, so who want to come with me. And yeah, people when come to Jamaica, it's, you know, shocked in a good way, of course. and everybody won't come back. Everybody understand a lot of things, and not only about the dance, because this was the thing changed myself. Not only the dance. When I went to Jamaica, I saw too many things that could open my mind, and I want this happen to the people in Europe and in Italy, because after this trip, they can really think in another way about dancing, music, culture, and life.
Yes, same thing as Alevanil said. I'm doing it since 2014, and I basically bring my students from Germany, but we got joined by people from all over Europe. The thing I'm noticing is there is a change happening in Jamaica through this type of dance tourism, especially in Kingston, from dance hall in the streets. And when we first went to Jamaica, we had to go in the streets or meet, she had to meet Latonya somewhere in the backyard, or I met with some dancers in their backyard in the ghetto to learn and dance. Differently than from what we are used to learn dancing in Europe, in a studio with a mirror and we're counting 5, 6, 7, 8, there was none of that. Since so many dance hall tourists came to Kingston, it changed. So we have a new studio dance hall scene in Kingston now. We have 2 dance hall studios where you can go to, where you can have classes. Also, all the street dancers, and they're street dancers, they're raw. They never learned dance hall in a professional way like we. They are brought to the studio now, and they are taught how to teach people to learn dancehall. So that's a new development in the dancehall scene. And as well as we're bringing those dancers to Europe, and they are brought to Europe and all over the globe to teach big workshops in front of many, many people, that's something very new for them, and it's a big development for the dancer scene in Kingston.
So does you come into Jamaica, to Kingston, to the dance hall, meeting the dancers, does that change the dance within the dance hall?
Yes. It obvious, or probably it influences the scene, yes. Because we're bringing new things from outside, and then European dancers link up with Jamaican dancers. They're doing choreography, so probably they, you know, pick up some things from our way to do choreographies. I know the younger dancers, they're also influenced a lot by YouTube videos now from dancer from all over the world, or dancers in general. So yes, it's also influencing from our side.
Yeah. So what you're saying is that Jamaicans are imitating their imitators.
They get influenced.
Imitating.
They're still doing their thing.
No, I'm just teasing you, because I think it's a great cultural exchange. Because, you know, one of the things that struck me in the documentary was when somebody said she saw the dances and she wanted to do it. So that there's that sense of the spectacularity of dance hall culture that catches people's attention outside, as they say, damn, I wish I could do that. And I really admire you guys who have taken it professionally, you have taken it seriously, you see this thing and you imitate it to the max, and what you're saying now, you actually add value to your imitation by bringing something new that Jamaicans can incorporate into their reproduction of their own culture.
But I think also it reminds me of some of the musical exchanges that have been taking place since, you know, the 60s onwards, and the way that Jamaican music, the popularity overseas, also affected the type of music that was made in Jamaica to a degree.
In the documentary, we could see some of the dancers talking about the struggles that they go through in their everyday life. And it seemed like dancing could somehow help them, you know, to find relief Maybe you can talk about your own experience, what dancing does to you, to your personal life.
Yeah, dance make me feel like at all free and myself, but I can connect these to the world culture. Because only when I went to Jamaica, I could understand more things about me, about my body and about my mind. So every time I go to Jamaica, I come back with something inside, and I really want to bring back something in some way. And yeah, it's like a circle. It's like Jamaica give me something and I work for give back. And this makes me feel happy when I do this. So yeah, everything is connect. More I get happiness, more I want to do. And trust me, this is the only thing I want from my life, do what I love and feel this emotion to me.
I wouldn't know what I would do, what I would be without dancehall. As I said, I do it for a living. So it's what I do 24/7. It's what I think of 24/7. So it gives me the possibility to let out emotions, and it brings me, same way, a lot of happiness, a lot of joy. And it gives me the possibility to play in different roles, which is an interesting thing for your person.
I just wanted to pick up on David's excellent point about the way in which the evolution of Jamaican music represents, you know, a variety of fusions, outside influences plus local contributions. But it seems that there comes a point where all of that mixing up coheres into something that you can call Jamaican culture, that is distinctive, that can then be copied, if you know what I mean. So I'm not,
yes.
I agree with you that there are all these influences, you know, R&B and jazz creating ska mixed with mento and then the evolution. But you know, you can feel that, yes, there are these, all these influences, but the influences come together and create something distinctive that is Jamaican.
Yes, indeed.
Before we open the discussion up to the audience, I would like to ask the two dancers who have both participated in Dancehall Queen contests, and maybe we can also include Corey, the filmmaker, who, you know, documented this Dancehall Queen contest in Montego Bay. You know, getting back to the question of female empowerment, how is the vibe among the dancers? How, you know, do you see each other as colleagues or as competitors? Do you fight backstage, or what is it like?
I don't know if I was lucky at the International Dancehall Queen, but I really enjoyed the experience, because every girl share something, every girl know each other, and really I enjoyed this more than the competition, because I think if it wasn't in that day, I couldn't meet all that girl in one moment, you know. It's something really special, but I feel more competition maybe in Europe or in Italy, if I had to say, you know, than a big competition like the International Dancehall Queen. But yeah, it depends. Of course, there is competition between the queens, but it always depends.
Okay, if Maggie doesn't have anything, maybe Corey, you have anything to add?
Yeah, it was kind of funny, because I thought going into the contest, when I met all of you, that you would be fighting, you know, because you're a lot of powerful women in one small space. And so the year that I came to International Dancehall Queen the first time, 2013, I think you were there maybe, or the year before. Yeah. The first year, the son of the owner of the competition was making a reality show about the girls in the mansion, and he thought that they would be drama, you know, like like, oh, this girl is talking shit about this girl. And nothing happened, so they couldn't make anything. Because all the girls were like, I love you too. And it really is like very beautiful, like sisters almost.
Everybody help each other.
Yeah.
So, and we are so busy in that days in the mansion, because even if you see the peak that we are on the beach, we work a lot. We do rehearsal and peaks for promo, many, many things. So everybody help each other in that. If I lost something, I found a girl can help me. And really, I didn't expect to, especially because people from other experience told me, oh, yeah, pay attention, you know. But yeah, nothing happened, and I'm so happy.
And can I just say that Jamaicans are very welcoming of foreigners who excel at our cultural forms, you know, so that although there may have been some sense of competition, there's also a sense of approval that people feel, boy, them good, them really catch it, you know, which is what I felt as I was watching the documentary. And the year I was one of the judges for the contest, what struck me was that if the Jamaican girl had not won, there was going to be a mutiny at Pier 1, you know, because she was obviously the crowd favorite. And even though there were some other good dancers, it was clear that the judges were going to be in big trouble if they hadn't selected her. And you saw the same thing happening in this contest, so that there's a sense of Jamaican pride that, yes, man, them good, but we can't make them come here and beat us.
Okay, unless anybody else on the panel has questions for our special.
I wanted Corey to give us some clarification about, I wasn't clear whether it was the film commissioned for television or is it meant to be a feature documentary, and how did you, you know, it obviously had a significant budget, you had professional camera work and editing, so can you tell us a bit about, you know, who commissioned the film, or did you make it off your own back, and where will it be screened from here?
Right, so I started off the film by spending my own money from making HBO money. And then I did a Kickstarter campaign, a crowdfunding campaign, and made a bulk of the budget from there, and then spent more of my own money. And so, you know, it's a mix of those two. And so now the process is, this is kind of like a preview, right? So I get some feedback from people like Carolyn and the Dance Hall Queens, and then I can make some fixes. And then we'll submit to festivals and do that whole thing, and just, yeah, it'll be a feature, like, documentary.
Can I say, though, don't do too much fixing, you know? You can leave the little girl in the front so that some people have something to say. Don't take it out.
No, it is important to have some controversy, right? Because that's what people talk about, so, yeah.
I have another question for Corey about the documentary. In the documentary, there's some very strong and touching moments. And so I think that from a filmmaker point of view, you can't write or plan that kind of things before. So I was wondering if you had some expectation or plans about the film, and if at the end you had what you were expecting for, or if something changed according to the what was coming out from the life of the dancer and the people.
Yeah, I think a lot of the scenes, we did anticipate some of those things happening, because I talked to the queens and we would say, like, we're gonna go have dinner for Ali's birthday, or, you know, those kind of things. Raquel, who's back there somewhere, the Spanish queen in the film, you know, she was like, we go to call my father every week, we call my father, so we knew every single week that happened, and that was the same emotional conversation. She said last night they have every single week. So I just talked to them, planned out some places we needed to be, and then everything was pretty much, I mean, as we expected, because, like, I had gone backwards sometime, and I knew who was going to win the competition, and so, you know, I kind of worked backwards from there on a lot of that stuff. Yeah.
Okay, now we want to give the public a chance to put questions to our special guests.
Just want to say something very quick. If you're interested to learn dancehall, we are here not for Reg University, but we're teaching dancehall workshops every day. We're a team of five dancers. Five. And we're every day at 5:30 at the beach, different beaches, Torreón and
Soleil.
You'll find it in the program. And we're every night teaching in the dancehall arena from 10 to 11. So I hope to see you there.
Hi. I have a question for Carolyn. I'd like to know what was the impact, like the start of this dancehall queen and the dancehall dancing, the more explicit part. Like, is there definitely links with the music, I'm guessing? And when did that change in the Jamaican music, when the slackness started?
Yeah. All right. We have always had slackness in Jamaican music. It didn't start with what we now call dancehall. If you listen to some mentor lyrics, you know, the folk music lyrics are very, quote-unquote, slack. We have Dennis Howard here, Dr. Howard. I'm not going to say he's an authority on slackness, but he's an authority on dancehall culture. His father is an important agent in the industry, so I want to ask Dennis to come and help me, because Dennis used to go to dance hall when I used to go to church. Okay, so it seems to me that we have always had slackness in dance hall in terms of the lyrics. We have always had dancing that was erotic in Jamaican culture, but I think there came a moment, and I don't know when we can pinpoint the date, maybe Dennis can, when the women came to the center as dancers. But as you heard, there are whole groups of male dancers who dance. And you know, one of the ironies of Jamaican homophobia is that you will have bands of men dancing together and nobody's going to say that they are gay. They may be, you know, but it's okay for men to dance together in groups. So I would say the dance hall the dancing bit would have been maybe the 90s. I don't know. That is when I would date it from, and you know, you've had an intensification of it. But over to Dennis.
The dancing has always been a key part of the dance hall. And I am really saddened by the fact that people believe that dance hall started with Bogle. And in fact, you have very, very popular dancers back in the days. You had people like Skianka, Sky Juice, who is a selector from Metro Media, started as a dancer. And so dancing was always a part of it. You have Al Capone, who used to dance with Admiral Bailey, both on stage and in the dance hall. But for some strange reason, there wasn't that prominence. So I'd say that the female dominance started in the 90s because of the bling-bling kind of culture. And dancing really took center place with the popularity of Bogle. And I had to correct a couple of dancers, because they used to say that dancehall and dancehall dance is Bogle. And without the pioneers from way back in the 50s, the 60s, the 70s, the 80s, there wouldn't be any dancers in the dance hall, because Jamaican music is essentially dance music. And so the dancers were an important part of it. You had people like Tom, Persian the Cat, Sparky and Pluggy, the Holly Golly Boys, Pom Pom. And when dancers back in those days were female, they had to have a male partner. There was no such thing as a female dancing alone in the dance hall. So the freedom of the female was the late 80s into the 90s.
I just want to to, I heard in Jamaica, and I really don't know if it's true or not, that there were an influence on the slackness music that started in the 90s in Jamaica, when Jamaica got cable and porn channel.
That added to the dimension, but cable and porn only gave rise to the acceptance of oral sex, because oral sex was kind of taboo back in Jamaica, and so you had the phenomenon of the bow cat, and it was down with bow cat, but with HBO and porn, everybody accepted oral sex, and so after a while there was no bow cat, or pardon my friend, suck pussy in dancehall lyrics. So I would say the slackness, as Carolyn just said, slackness was always a part of it. Every legendary artist from Jamaica, including Bob Marley, had a double entendre or an outright dirty song. Guava Jelly is a dirty song, but it's just done in nice form. Come rub it on my belly like guava jelly. It only could suggest two things, and you know those two things. And from Lee Scratch Perry had one called Sweet Pussy, and had lyrics like sweet fucking in the lyrics. So dancehall, well, I'm not sure about Jimmy Cliff, because Jimmy Cliff converted to Islam quite early. But even another Muslim in the form of Prince Buster had a plethora of dirty song. Big Five fucking, all kind of dirty, really nasty songs. And of course, you have people, the song from Alec Badesi, a mentor song, singer, which was one of the first songs to be banned in Jamaica, called Night Food, which now is very innocuous, but back then it was the most outrageous song, and he should have been jailed for doing that song. So slackness became the thing with the emergence of King Yellowman, and he had a great performance on stage. But Yellowman will tell you that he never did slackness. He did sex music. So for him, there was a clear distinction: sex music and slackness, two different things. Lady Saw tell you that she don't do sex slackness. She's just performing. It's a performance. And the irony about Lady Saw before she converted, if you had a discussion about sex with Lady Saw as Marian Hall, she would run away from it. She was very shy, and she was almost schizophrenic. Lady Saw raw on the stage, Marian Hall scared of talking about sex.
Any more questions from the audience?
Hello. This is a question probably for everyone, but I'd really like to hear Carolyn's opinion. I'm a youth worker, and I work specifically with girls, young women, and especially girls in gangs. And I wanted to talk about the sort of, I would say, epidemic among very young women that maybe aren't as confident or as powerful as you two may be. But the problem is they view themselves, they see sort of idealized, powerful women being very sexual in their nature, but they themselves are very vulnerable. And then perform these kind of sexual dances, and it is causing great problems for them in their own sort of psychological well-being, and through abuse as well. And I wanted to just point that out as a problem that we have. Yeah.
You've raised a very sensitive issue about the politics of representation, how young women see themselves and how they see women who are performing sexual roles that they themselves can't manage. And I think this is why it's so important to have conversations about music, conversations about the girl's own sexuality and conversations about performance. This is exactly the point that Dennis just made, that somebody like Lady Saw makes a clear distinction between her persona as an actress. As she says, Lady Saw is an act. She makes a distinction between the performance of a role for entertainment and her own identity. And somebody has to talk to these girls, maybe you, you know, in your interaction with them, to say, don't mix up the performance with reality. And, you know, unless you have that kind of conversation with the girls, they will then make the mistake of thinking that they can go and perform these sexualized roles without consequences. Whereas on the stage, you have the distance, visible distance of performance. I'm up there and there's an audience. But if you do that kind of performance in a dance, there's not that mediating space to distinguish between reality and performance. And then somebody watches you doing the dance and they mistake it for a literal invitation. And then you don't know how to say no. And then you end up in trouble. So we have to have these conversations.
It's a very sensitive topic, yes. There is a reason why there is clean and raw versions in dancehall. And when I'm teaching dancehall, I make sure I use clean versions, because especially if I know there's minor girls, minor people under 18 in the class, I won't use raw versions. I won't show younger girl students the sexually explicit whining moves. Is not for them. I wouldn't show them dancehall queen style. Is not for them, in my opinion. I was in Poland, I think last week, I was judging a dancehall battle, and on the list we saw the age of the girls, and the DJ, she was playing all kind of raw, sexually raw dancehall tunes, and then there were girls coming up with 11 years, 13 years, 14 years, and they were all doing that stuff. And when I saw the age, I was like, no, stop. Don't play those tunes, and you girls don't do that stuff. But the problem is, many people in Europe who teach dance, they don't really know what they're doing. They don't understand the lyrics. They don't know what it's about, and they don't think as far as they should. So yeah, it's a problem as well for us to teach dance. And they should be aware of.
Perhaps we need to license dancehall instructors. There's a whole business now of licensing and determining who is fit to teach dancehall.
You mean license to teach? I used to teach before then soul, other kind of dance, but yeah, well, I have a license like to teach dance soul. Now I get the Latonia did the stylish move course certification. Is something about her style. It's called stylish move, and it's a really good thing because she prepared us in every sense. So not only about dances, she gave us info. And this is the most important thing, yeah, how we say it until now.
Yeah, I know Dennis wants to come in, but you know, I said it somewhat frivolously, but if you think of the creative industries, you know, you need to think of dance hall as something that is a process, it's a commodity, it's a cultural agent, and that it needs to be taken seriously. And if you take it seriously, once you start to teach or to say, I can teach dance hall, you need to understand the cultural context. There are things that you need to know about the music, the lyrics, and so what you guys are doing intuitively. But perhaps we can, you know, sort of commercialize it, and Jamaicans can start having a certification system in place that if you want to come and teach dance hall, you come and learn and you get your certificate, and we say, all right, we can let you loose on the world now.
Yeah, we are just a filter. So we have to be the better filter as possible.
I'm very sorry that I have to stop this discussion, but unfortunately we have to wrap it up because the next event is happening at 6:30. That's the way it goes. But I don't want you to leave before telling you that tomorrow we start at 6 o'clock with a session with a special guest. Pablo Moses is going to be here. We're going to talk about his life and music. And after that, at 7:30, we have Morgan Heritage here. We won't have Iberosi. He had to cancel his presence here at Reggae University, but we have Morgan Heritage instead. So make sure you'll be here on time. And on your way out, please make sure you stop by iNation, who is just left on the left side of Reggae University, is selling books and T-shirts, and it's just worth meeting the man.
And thanks again for everybody who took part in it. You know, it was a great session. Give thanks, and thanks for the great outcome of people.